Welcome you all, and thank you for being here. We are thrilled about the level of interest in really looking at the connection between poverty and involvement in the child welfare system. So again, we've got a great lineup for you. I want to thank David Labine for his work. Some of you know him from you probably are colleagues with him at the School of Social Work, but we are very fortunate to have him, and I'm very fortunate personally, to have him as my intern this year. So it's fabulous, and he, I don't know where he is right, oh, there he is, has really, really been the lead organizer, and then, of course, colleagues at Partners for Our Children and others of you. So thank you for being here, and I'm going to turn it over to Todd Herrenkohl, who is the Dean of Research at the School of Social Work, and he will be our MC and give further instructions about the morning. But welcome and thank you for being here.
Great. Well, good morning, everybody. I'm thrilled to be here representing the School of Social Work and helping to moderate the session. Again, my name is Todd Herrenkohl. I'm the Associate Dean for Research at the school and also a faculty member there. So welcome to you all. Just a couple of housekeeping details as we get underway. And I apologize for referring to my notes, but I want to make sure I cover all that we need to cover. We have one table for presenters. So we're going to be kind of shuffling people back and forth. So just bear with us as we kind of go through that routine. I'll be the timekeeper. I'll keep us sort of running on time today. And I will do my best to keep things organized and moving along. Restrooms, if you need them, are just out this door. You'll see signs to the, David, I think said to the left, but take a look, walk out this door straight back and look for signs for the restrooms. If you have cell phones, of course, please turn those off or put those, the ringers on mute so that we're not disturbing our presenters this morning. One member of the panel will, not this panel, but the next, I believe, will be joining us by Skype. So that will involve a little bit of technology, and you'll have to roll with us on that one as well. And one last note, we'll have evaluations at the end of the session today. So please stick around to complete those evaluations. It's important for the organizers of the forum today to get some feedback from you all. So the format for the forum is a two-session format with a 15-minute break in between. Hopefully we'll have enough time to fit everybody in and to cover what we need to cover. The first session is about 90 minutes in total. There'll be some research presentations by our distinguished guests here, followed by a panel analysis and then a Q&A period in which you all can ask questions of the presenter. Session two, then, will be about 55 minutes in length and will include a panel analysis building on what's covered in the first part of the forum this morning. And again, a Q&A period at the end of that. So there'll be ample time for you all to ask questions of the panelists. So please hold those until the designated Q&A period. So as Lori kind of mentioned, the goals for the forum today are to develop an understanding of the association between poverty and child welfare involvement, to examine some of the causes of poverty, including the structural underpinnings of poverty, and to explore priorities for practice and policy focused on reducing the number of families living in poverty. This is where I need three hands or three arms. Okay, so in this first session, the presenters will start us off by helping to kind of explore how to define poverty, so taking a look at whether there is, in fact, an association between poverty and child welfare, and also to comment briefly on what our state, or maybe not so briefly, maybe in depth, on what our state is currently doing to address the connection between poverty and child welfare involvement. The presenters here will help set the groundwork for the panel discussion that follows that. So that, again, we're going to roll right into that second panel. So please bear with us through that transition. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead, without taking any more of the valuable time this morning, to introduce our presenters for the first part of the forum today. We have Professor Jennie Romich from the School of Social Work. and currently the director of the West Coast Poverty Center. We have Joe Mienko from Partners for Our Children. We have Barb Lucenko, who is in the Research and Data Analysis Division at DSHS. And last but not least, we have Logan MacGregor from Economic Services Administration at DSHS. So with that, I will hand it off to Jennie, who's going to get us underway.
Thank you, Abby.
Good morning. Thanks for your interest. As Todd said, I'm Jennie Romich. I'm the faculty director for the West Coast Poverty Center here at the University of Washington. We are a collection of about 40 faculty affiliates from the School of Social Work, the School of Public Affairs, different departments in arts and sciences and public health. And we all share a common interest in poverty somehow related to our work, and work to communicate with policymakers and to nurture the next generation of poverty scholars. So I'm pleased to be here, and I'm absolutely thrilled about what I heard about the response to today's event and the interest in considering the nexus between poverty and child welfare. This has been a slow running interest of mine over the last few years as I've gotten to know folks at POC and worked a bit with them, and I think it's a critical issue, and I'm probably preaching to the choir on that. So my goal here today is to just provide a little bit of an overview, Poverty 101 on poverty in Washington State. So as you probably know, the way the government officially measures poverty is by drawing a line, the federal poverty line, that distinguishes folks who are poor from folks who are not poor. You can see, throughout this I'll be using data from the most recent census data available, which is for last year. So I'll be using 2014 numbers. They're updated modestly every year for inflation. But when we talk about the poverty rate, we're talking about folks whose income are below the poverty threshold. So for a single adult, that's about $1,000 a month. For a family of four, that is about $2,068 a month. There are a lot of complaints about the poverty line, one of which is it's way too low when we think about the cost of living. So. I wanted to talk a bit about why we use this legacy measure, and here's a picture of the legacy. This is not Instagram to look old. It is not thrift store clothing. This is a Social Security economist in the 1960s. Her name was Molly Orshansky, and as part of the war on poverty, our probably second wave effort in the U.S. to really seriously think about and reduce poverty, there was a consensus that we needed to have some kind of systematic way of measuring it. And Orshansky, who had started her life as an economist in the USDA working on food budgets, kind of thought this through and said, you know, families spend about a third of their income on food. The USDA calculates a thrifty food budget. So not bare bones, but lots of beans and rice. Let's multiply that number by three and say if you're under it, you're poor. And let's see, 1960, 50 some years later, we're still using the same measure. That's kind of gotten some, it just become part of the system, even though there are a lot of ways that people think it is a less than ideal measure. In fact, in Ms. Orshansky's obituary, Dr. Orshansky's obituary in the New York Times a few years ago, there was a little discussion about the measure itself. And she herself was a lifelong liberal Democrat, deeply committed to race and equity issues. And she said, you know, the best thing that could be said about the measures, when they needed it, it was there. So even she had some notion that this wasn't right. So let me present some other factual-based information about poverty versus living expenses in Washington State to get some context for this. The geographic center of Washington State is in Chelan County. So that's what I'll use here. Anyone in the audience from Chelan? Bummer. Okay. These are figures about the cost of living in Chelan County, as calculated by my colleague Diana Pierce from the Center for Women's Welfare here at UW. And these are meant to be kind of standard, basic, unsupplemented income levels. What does it cost to rent a basic apartment what does it cost to buy basic food, health care, and so on. This is for a two-person household, one adult with one preschooler. And you can look at the various things here. Housing, about $758 a month in Chelan County. This is based on HUD fair market rent. All of these are based on different publicly available data sources. But they add up all together to not quite $3,000 a month, or about $35,000 a year. And we have the same figures for a single adult, where it adds up to about $1,500 a month, or a four-person family. So here you can see these basic costs of living on an annual basis relative to the poverty threshold, the poor versus not poor line I presented earlier. And in all cases, what we know about what it actually costs to maintain a basic standard of living is substantially higher than what is considered poor by the poverty measure. So for a single adult, basic expenses, and these are pretty basic, add up to about $18,000 a year, which is 50% more than the poverty line. The disparity gets even higher once you start having kids and think about the cost of childcare, which is necessary for parents who are earning in the market. So it's about twice the poverty line for those other figures. So as we go back to the picture of the poverty line, I actually think there are a few different elements that are important to think about. Poor versus non-poor is still important. Kind of, are you below the line or above the line? But we should also think about folks who are low income. They're not poor by the official measure, but they're below 200%, which is much closer to what we think it actually costs to raise a child. So when I present the data about Washington State, I'll be presenting information about these folks we call low income, or we think of them as having not enough income to sustain kind of a basic minimal standard of living without some help. I'm also going to present numbers on deep poverty. One of the things that's happened over the last several decades in the U.S. has been a slow and steady increase in families living in really severe poverty. I have some colleagues at the University of Michigan and Johns Hopkins who just wrote a book called $2 a Day on Extreme Poverty in the U.S. $2 a day used to be, and still is, the marker used by international development experts to think about poverty in developing countries. But it's actually becoming an increasingly relevant figure in the U.S. by itself. Somewhere around one quarter of high school dropouts, or women without a high school degree who are raising kids, are living on somewhere in that range, or they have really no discernible sources of income, no earnings, and no cash from public assistance. So I'm going to present information on folks in deep poverty as well. So here's where we stand in Washington State right now. About 7 in 10 Washingtonians are neither poor nor low income. About 3 in 10 folks in our state are poor, or low income. Overall, our poverty rate is 12%, and that includes 5% who are in deep poverty, less than half of that line, and 7%, another 7% who are closer to the poverty line but still under it. So this is how we're doing overall. Because of the topic today, I also wanted to drill down a little bit on child poverty and early child poverty. And here we do less well. About more than 4 in 10 Washington kids live in a household where they are poor or low income. So more than 4 out of every 10 kids. This is statewide, not the child welfare population that you'll hear more about overall. And we worry about child poverty as a general social issue. Kids who grow up in poverty are less engaged in school. They're more likely to be poor as adults. They report to researchers that they're less happy than kids who grow up in non-low-income households. So, Next, I'll turn to kind of the geographic distribution of poverty over the state. And for these maps going forward, I owe thanks to Elena Hernandez from the Washington Center on Budget and Policy. You'll hear from Lori Pfingst from their group later on today. But Budget and Policy did the work to present this information by legislative district, which is a nice way of thinking about the geographic distribution across the state. So the first thing I'll talk about is deep poverty. These are folks living on less than half the poverty line. The highest point, the highest poverty district is in Spokane. We also have rates of high extreme or high deep poverty in the 15th and 16th district as well. Here's the detail on the Puget Sound, where you can see slightly more deep poverty down through the south end of the sound as well. Next, I'll show information on the poverty numbers itself, and you'll you'll see the same areas show up as having deep poverty, and then poverty overall. One surprise in the Seattle area, the highest poverty legislative district in Seattle is actually the 43rd that you are sitting in right now. This is one where I always ask, I teach a class on poverty and inequality, and I ask the students where they think the highest poverty region is in Seattle, and often they'll say South County, but it's always kind of a surprise, and then when they think through it, well, the way the measurement happens is a lot of UW students get counted as poor. So this is not the type of poverty I worry the most about. I think that's kind of temporary life cycle poverty, but I do worry about communities that have persistent rates of poverty and low income over time. So, here's the same information on low income status, both overall and for the Puget Sound. The next few speakers, Barb and Logan in particular, are going to talk about the supports families can receive from economic services, whether it's TANF or foods, basic food assistance. So I have a few more slides here about where there's the greatest participation in economic services. And again, you can see some of the same groups, but also a little more variation. Actually, the legislative district with the highest ESA participation is in South Puget Sound, is the 51st, I think. Let's go to the next one. Nope. 29th, so south of Tacoma there. So this hopefully gives you a sense of where the needs are and where the resources are over the state. Before I close, I did want to talk a little bit about some of the research I've done with the assistance of DSHS and Partners for Our Children. My colleague Maureen Marcenko, who you'll hear from later this year, and I have been looking over time at the question of what resources do families in the child welfare system have? What economic resources do they have? And we were particularly concerned about this growing group of families who don't seem to have any income, so they're not working, and they're not receiving cash assistance. So we've done a few different projects over time trying to understand this group that we call economically disconnected families. So the next slide here, this is from the 2008 statewide survey of child welfare involved parents, the parent study that was a collaboration between DSHS and POC. And Maureen and I and our team looked at the data in there and asked the question of what resources are families, or caregivers reporting having at the time of removal. And for the child welfare population in general, or in this survey, about 40% had income from employment. They had a job that they were earning money from. Another 40% were reported receiving some cash assistance from the state, whether that's a Work First grant or perhaps some SSI for someone in the household. But fully 2 in 10 reported neither of those sources of income. And if you think back to the poverty rates, Joe will be talking a little bit more about poverty rates over different aspects of the child welfare system. But my guess is all of these folks, and probably a chunk of these, are poor as well. So I think this is definitely a very important topic to think about, to think through the role of resources and what we can be doing to further the opportunities of families and kids in the child welfare system. So, somewhere in your packet or in your information, there's a link to some research briefs prepared from this work.
It's on the back of this.
All right, it's on the back, and there are QR codes if you're the type of person who can scan those. I'm not that type of person, so there are also URLs that you can poke into your tiny phone to bring up some of the research briefs that we've done on this topic. So thank you all for your attention, and I look forward to the rest of the day.
Well, thank you, Jennie, and as I think you've heard a few times, I just want to echo the sentiment of excitement at how much interest there was in this forum. I think this is a very good thing to see, and this level of interest in a very important topic. So, as we work through the presenters and at this table and throughout the rest of the day, we're sort of going to get deeper and deeper into the child welfare system and the aspects of poverty surrounding the child welfare system. So, as Jennie has talked about poverty in the state overall, I'm going to dig in on the child welfare system a little bit. Before I do that, though, I want to start off just with an overview of what I would call a child welfare decision point framework. So I want, for those of you that are child welfare insiders, you'll see that this is a gross simplification of the way work is done in the child welfare system, but it's, for the sake of discussion today, I think it's useful to think about the way children move through the system. And once I set that up, I want to talk about the prevalence of poverty at each of those decision points. And this is a difficult thing to measure, as you'll see, but we've got access to a unique set of data that allows us to look at this in an interesting way. And then just a brief discussion about possible intervention points and how to think about intervention points given the prevalence of poverty throughout this child welfare decision point framework. So to start with, what are we talking about in terms of decision points? In trying to understand poverty, I think it's helpful to have a relevant comparison group. So we want to start with looking at all children in the state of Washington. All children in the state of Washington are at risk of child welfare system involvement. So that's we start from a point of birth in this overview here. So among children that are born in the state of Washington, they're all at risk of being reported to the child welfare system. Most often this is for some sort of allegation of child abuse or neglect, but we use the term report here because we want to be all encompassing in the ways that children come into contact with the system. Once you're reported, the child welfare system can do a few different things. And again, gross simplification here, but the case can get closed. You can go on to be served in the home, or you can receive some sort of out-of-home services, or you can have a stay in out-of-home care. So these, as we move through the presentation, I just for the sake of space on some of these graphs, I use these abbreviations, RPT for report, CLS for closure, IHS for in-home services, and OHS for out-of-home services, and hopefully that can stay in your working memory for the next few minutes. So, moving on into this flowchart here, you might ask, well, I see some of those acronyms, but you've almost doubled the number of decision points. And the reason we've done that is because children don't always come into contact with the child welfare system once. They can come into contact with the system once, but they can also come back again several times here. So we've, for the sake of simplicity, we've just modeled the second point here, but it's helpful to think about the fact that we don't always just get to see these kids once. They come into contact with the system, they exit through some of these pathways, but then they often come back for a second report and also for third, fourth, and several reports sometimes. So we can only be born once, but we can have we can experience a lot of these transition points, a lot of these decision points at multiple points throughout a childhood. So, next slide. So, trying to assess the prevalence of poverty by decision point. My problem here, well, the question I want to ask is this: what percentage of children are in poverty at each decision point? The problem that we deal with, as many in this room are well aware, is that indicators of poverty just don't tend to show up very often in administrative data. So if we're looking at children that are involved in the child welfare system, there are things that are probably correlated with poverty in the administrative data, but few measures of poverty itself. So there's a variety of ways that we can handle this. Jennie mentioned going out into the community and actually surveying the child welfare involved families, and we've done that in the past. Another way that we can do this is to link the child welfare system data to other administrative data sources. So what I'm going to show here is an effort that builds off of work that's been done by a colleague of mine at USC, Emily Putnam-Hornstein, and in partnership with Casey Family Programs here in Seattle. And that is to bring together some of these child welfare system records with birth record data. And we take all of the birth records, we take all of the birth records for children born over a period of time, and with a computer, we match them up with the child welfare system records. And once we do that, we can move on to at least a crude measure of poverty in the birth record data that's not in the child welfare system data. And that is the source of payment from the child's birth, whether or not it was a public source, primarily Medicaid, or a private source. Now, going back to Jennie's presentation, this is more a measurement of being poor as opposed to that deep poverty. As many of us are well aware, the eligibility for Medicaid is close to that 200% of the poverty threshold, and it certainly was at the point at which we pulled these data, but it's still a sense of financial difficulty based on what we heard in the last presentation. So the bottom line here is that instead of asking what percentage of children are in poverty at each decision point, we can ask what percentage of children at each decision point were born in poverty. So we look back to that birth record and we see what percentage of children in each of those decision points were born in poverty. So next slide. So I did a brief view of the data, and these slides will be available after, but just for the sake of time, why don't we go to the next slide here. And so just to recall that decision point flow, and recall these colors in particular, as we go to the next slide. So we start with birth here on the far left. So I've modeled that decision tree all the way through to that second stay in out-of-home care. And what this shows is the percent of children that experienced that decision point in 2013 that had an associated birth record that indicated public payment for the birth. So we see that about half of the children in the state are born on public assistance of some sort, and that's pretty consistent with data you'll see reported from the Department of Health. But as we move on into that first report, we see that the prevalence of poverty goes up to 75%. As we move deeper into the system, to that first out-of-home care, we are approaching, you know, well over 80, close to 90% of the children that experienced that first out-of-home care placement had a public form of birth payment. And that pattern repeats itself with a slight increase overall, slight main effect overall, as you come back into contact for the second time. And if you track these data forward throughout the child welfare system for that third contact, that fourth contact, you'll see that there's marginal increases, steady increases, as you come into those subsequent contacts with the child welfare system. The prevalence of poverty increases. Next slide. So I want to touch just briefly on the choice of intervention point, okay? And I think this is just a helpful thing to keep in the back of our minds as we move throughout the day and move into the policy tool discussion. The purpose of that flowchart is to talk about various points that we can likely intervene with the system, and this isn't intended to be a normative statement, but it's just intended to be something that we need to keep in mind as we think about this problem. So next slide. So if we translate those percentages into numbers, right, the raw numbers of kids that exist at each of those decision points, we see at birth we've got a little over 40,000 kids that are involved in that have some sort of public form of birth payment associated with their birth record. That number goes down to about 30,000 when we look at those first reports, and gets smaller and smaller, down to just over 5,000 when we look at those first out-of-home stays. Then we're looking at 2013 data here. Next slide. So just to keep make this a little bit real for all of us, let's convert that into dollars, all right? And we can take what has in recent years become a relatively modest poverty intervention, is it the UK child benefit, which works out to about $1,500 per year per child. Next slide. You can see that pattern sort of is replicated here, but now in real dollars. We look at for a hypothetical annual cost of that modest poverty intervention, we're looking at over $60 million to attack the problem at the beginning point for the children at the point of birth. But we look at a relatively modest hypothetical annual cost to attack the problem later on. But if we go back to that previous slide, we see that's where the need is the greatest, right? So the prevalence of poverty is the greatest at the point of that first out-of-home care stay, and this hypothetical annual cost of this modest poverty intervention is the lowest there. So I'm sure this generated a lot of questions, but we probably want to move on to Barb. So, thanks very much for your time.
Hi, my name is Barb Lucenko. I'm with the Research and Data Analysis Division of DSHS, and we're a research office that sits in the central offices of DSHS. So we work with a lot of administrative data from the various programs and bring client data together so that we can report out on multiple systems and services. So what I'm going to talk about today is the overlap between populations, service populations, and services, between the economic services system and the child welfare system in Washington State. So two main questions that I want to get to today are: how much overlap exists between the receipt of economic services and involvement in the child welfare system in Washington State? And that's for kids and adults, so we're going to look at those separately. And then also I want to look at what proportion of the Washington State population is accessing each service. And the services we're going to look at are Medicaid coverage, temporary assistance for needy families, or TANF, basic food, or SNAP, child welfare services, and that includes case management and CPS involvement, and then drilling down to foster care. So first we're going to take a look at kids in Washington State age 0 to 17 who are served through our public systems.
So the first thing we'll notice when we look at our child welfare and poverty program populations is that there is a great deal of overlap with respect to kids and the services that they're getting from these systems. Of the 96,000 plus kids in the child welfare system during fiscal year 14, over a fourth of those received TANF services, and of those who received TANF services, many were child-only cases. 60% of those kids in the child welfare system were on basic food. 83% were on Medicaid. And then when we drill down to the smaller universe of children in foster care at some point during state fiscal year 14, so that could have been for one day or it could have been for 365 days, just keep that in mind. Of those 15,000 plus children, 45% received TANF services, and 71% of those on TANF were child-only cases. About half received basic food, and just about all of them were on Medicaid. Now, looking at the 119,000 children receiving TANF in fiscal year 14, so now looking through our economic services lens, 21% received some Children's Administration service, almost 20% had Child Protective Services. And then looking at the larger universe of about a half million kids who received basic food in fiscal year 14, 10% had a CPS case, and 2%, so a very small percentage, were in foster care. So again, much larger universe of children who are on basic food. So the Venn diagram just helps us get a sense for what proportions of the entire Washington state population are receiving each one of these services. And you can see, based on the large circle, that of the 1.6 million children in Washington state in fiscal year 14, that over half of those at least received at least one of the five services that we're talking about today. And the bulk of that is made up by, of course, the half of the population that were enrolled in Medicaid in that year, and about a third of the population that was receiving basic food. And again, we're talking about children. A very small proportion of the entire Washington state population were in foster care, so just 1%. 8% on TANF, and 6% served through some service by the Children's Administration. So just to give you a sense of comparison to the general Medicaid population, when we look at these proportions of children served, we see that kids with child welfare system involvement are more likely to have TANF, but are actually less likely to have basic food services than those in the general Medicaid population in any given year. And we know that that is likely due to the fact that some child welfare involved children qualify for child-only TANF assistance, but live with caregivers whose incomes exceed the limits for basic food. So I'm just gonna skip to the next slide. So now moving on to adults. We see when we focus on the universe of adults served by our various systems that there's actually a little bit less overlap between the DSHS child welfare and poverty service populations than what we saw for children and youth. So of the 83,000 plus adults who were involved with the child welfare system in fiscal year 14, 15% received TANF, and 58% were on basic food, and about half were on Medicaid. The total of 64% received some sort of medical or economic assistance. And of the 71,000 adults receiving TANF in fiscal year 14, you see that 16% of those adults were involved with a CPS case, with a Child Protective Services case. And just to make a comparison that I think will be of interest to the audience, of the close to a million adults receiving basic food, 4% were involved with a CPS case. So it does appear that more severe poverty, as indicated by being a part of a TANF benefit, is related to child welfare system involvement. Next slide, please. So another Venn diagram that is specific to adults illustrates that there's a smaller proportion here who are receiving one of the services that we're looking at today. So about 24% of the state's 5.4 million adults in fiscal year 14 received at least one of these services, and about 11% received two or more of these services. The other thing that we notice is that there's a bit less overlap between the two systems when it comes to adults. And of course, most of the adults who are receiving services are receiving Medicaid, basic food, or both. So in summary, there's a pretty large segment of the population in Washington State receiving economic services, particularly basic food and Medicaid. DSHS, child welfare, and economic services, child populations have significant overlap. We saw that of the children served by the child welfare system, most are enrolled in at least one poverty program, basic food, TANF, and or Medicaid, and usually more than one. We saw that there's less overlap for adults than for children between their child welfare system involvement or services received and economic services received. And we also saw that more severe poverty, as indicated by receipt of TANF, appears to be a risk factor for child welfare system involvement. And that's all I have for you today. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Logan MacGregor, and I work in the Office of the Assistant Secretary in Economic Services Administration. Next slide. I want to say thank you very much on behalf of ESA for letting us join you here. This is an area that I am very personally attached to, and I think is very important for ESA. I want to say a little bit about, you know, what we do. We provide benefits to people and services they need to be self-sufficient. We have more than 4,000 employees in over 60 offices all throughout the state, and one of our key focuses is partnerships. Next slide, please. I want to talk about some key safety net programs, and then I'm going to talk about what happens to those key safety net programs when there is an out-of-home placement. So first I want to note that I'm talking about some of these key safety net programs, particularly SSI, are not safety net programs that are administered by ESA, but they intersect with the same population, so I want to highlight the population. SSI provides stipends to disabled individuals. Those can be both adults and children. I think the current grant standard is $674. There are 150,000 cash recipients in Washington State. About 18,000 of those are children, so it's a significant number of children are receiving those benefits because they have a disability. Basic Food Program is a program formerly known as Food Stamps. The official name is the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, or SNAP. We call it Basic Food for layman's terms. In Washington State, we have about 1 million recipients of basic food currently, in the most current month of data. About a third of those, about 36% of those, are children. So again, a big intersection with the program there. Next slide. So the next major program I want to touch on is Temporary Assistance for Needy Families, or TANF. It's a cash assistance program for needy families. And some participate in the Workforce Program, which provides vocational assistance, help getting a job, help keeping a job. And there are 31,000 families right now that are receiving TANF in Washington State. About 50% of those families are families with one child in the home. Another 25, for a total of like three quarters of the population, have two or fewer children in the home. And about 5% of the cases are pregnant women without children. And then the last key focus area I want to talk about is child support enforcement. And The services include, of course, the establishment of support orders, collection, distribution of those support orders. You don't really have a CASA per se because it works a little bit differently. We talk about child support, we talk about the impact in terms of cost offsets, the programs, the benefits and services people don't need because they receive child support. And the impact in Washington for child support is estimated in state fiscal year 2015 at $139 million. It's a pretty big program. So here, it's really difficult to talk about in a few minutes how programs, how eligibility affects programs. So I'm providing a very simplified example here of the grant standard, the income limits, and the resource limits for a typical family of three. And keep in mind, this is a grossly simplified matrix, but you can see that the SSI grant standard is 733. I previously said it was 734. I'm sorry about the $1 inaccuracy there. The TANF standard for a family of three is $521, and the basic food standard is for $511. For child support, it's not an income-based program, but they do have a low-income minimum support order of $50. So if you're a low-income parent, you're still required to participate in support enforcement, but your support order can be set at $50. The other thing I want to highlight is there are numerous income and resource exclusions. TANF has a 50% earned income disregard, SSI has the same earned income disregard, Basic Food Program has a 20% earned income disregard. SSI, you can exclude $2,000 in non-excludable resources. TANF has a $1,000 non-excludable resource limit. We exclude a $5,000 equity value of vehicles, so we don't count the first $5,000 of the vehicle because transportation is important to people. Next slide, please. So now I want to get to the meat and potatoes of the presentation, which is what happens when a child is removed by Children's Administration and placed in an out-of-home placement. And that was a decision point that Joe talked about. So for SSI, the benefits are tied to the person. So if that person is a child, then the SSI cash grant follows the child into that other home. For TANF, we have a program called Concurrent Benefits, which means when there's a family reunification plan in place, we can continue to provide cash benefits for up to 6 months. That can actually be extended beyond 6 months if reunification is still the plan. Basic food benefits, unfortunately, are reduced to reflect the smaller household size. So in our previous example, it was $511 for a family of three. If my math is correct, I think it's $347 for a family of two. Child support, when there's a family unification in place, DCS does not open a new support order. So, and again, when families do have to participate in child support enforcement, there is the $50 minimum for low-income families. Next slide. So, again, we're short in time, so I'm kind of going through quickly, so I hope I'm not going too quickly. I want to pivot here a little bit because, you know, I was just talking about the program rules and what happens in an out-of-home placement. And I'll talk a little bit about generational poverty and what we're doing to address adverse childhood experiences and incorporate emerging brain science, if you will. And I want to be very careful here when I talk about generational poverty. I know that there was a recent Utah Commission report that talked about intergenerational poverty and its association with child welfare. I haven't seen anything that puts a strong connection between intergenerational poverty and increased risk of child welfare involvement. I think there's some more research is probably needed in that area. And you know, as this slide I think will demonstrate, it's kind of difficult to measure. We looked at the adult TANF caseload with parents under the age of 36, and we found that 37% had received TANF themselves as a child. That's I think an understatement of the significance of generational poverty in our population, because we have a database that only goes back to 1997, and we've tried really hard to find data before 1997, and we just can't do it. So this is, we know that it's at least 37% and probably more. Next slide. So the next thing we want to talk about is that when we're talking about the things that are needed to support early childhood development, they're consistent with the things that we would want when we're promoting self-sufficiency. So, you know, identifying, I'm hoping people are aware with the ACE study, but identifying and mitigating adverse childhood experiences, reducing toxic stress, these are the same things that build strong communities, that promote educational outcomes, ultimately leading to employment and self-sufficiency. So, so it's something that we fully embrace. Last slide. And so one example, and I'm going to put a plug in here for Ann Stone, who's our director of the Frontiers of Innovation Project. She's in our audience here. We are participating in a nationwide effort coordinated with Harvard University Center on the Developing Child. They call it the Frontiers of Innovation Project. In Washington State, it's a cross-agency project involving multiple state agencies, multiple community-based agencies, multiple service providers, academic researchers, and really just looking for innovations and opportunities to share information to help guide our work. And we recently had had a work group that met for about 6 months and provided a nice summary of things that we might want to consider. And so, you know, as we're talking about these issues, we want to focus on a broader perspective. So, thank you very much.
Okay, let's give our presenters a round of applause once again. To transition. Thank you. Just a reminder that we're going to hold questions until the end of the panel presentation, and I'll invite now our panelists to come up and take a seat at the table. And as they're doing that, let me just kind of recap a few things from the session we just heard. Professor Romich did a very nice job of telling us a bit about sort of how poverty status is determined and how our state, Washington State, fares with respect to poverty numbers and how poverty rates are determined, or distributed, I'm sorry, across the state. Joe Mienko followed that and talked about RPTs and CLSs and IHSs. Hope you all sort of remember what those stand for. We're really kind of commenting about decision points and how kids who come in contact with the child welfare system on multiple occasions tend to come from poverty backgrounds. Barb Lucenko commenting on the relationship or the overlap between economic services and child welfare involvement, and then Logan MacGregor, as we just heard, talking about safety net programs and also commenting on ACEs and child development. So a very nice kind of foundation, if you will, for our panelists now to comment on. And I think we're missing a couple of people, are we not? So let me go ahead and introduce our panelists. And actually, two of the folks I don't know, but I'm going to take a... Actually, are you Alise?
I am Alise.
All right. So I got that right. So let me go ahead and introduce our three panelists. We have Alise Hegle.
Yes. No, everybody does that wrong. That
well,
awesome.
I have it actually kind of written out here. So.
Oh, did you? Oh, I'm so excited.
Who is a parent and advocacy project manager for the Children's Home Society of Washington State. We have, I think, Leroy Pelton, who's joining us by Skype. Is that correct?
Yeah, we're just trying to.
Okay, so he'll be up here momentarily. Dee Wilson, who is with the KC Family Programs. And Esther Wanchihia. All right, two for two. Who is with the Children's Administration as a caseworker. So we thank you all for joining us. I appreciate your being here. And our panelists are asked to sort of build from the session we just heard, the presentations we just heard, by commenting on questions having to do to how the information relates to larger regional and national trends. What theories and frameworks can help us understand the connections that our presenters talked about? And how do research findings relate to sort of the lived experiences of families, of parents, and of child welfare workers? So again, we thank you for being here, and I'll just hand it off to, who's going to get us underway, Elise?
I wasn't, unfortunately, able to hear the presentations very well.
Okay, the people on the mics, we'll just ask them to speak up a little bit more.
Yeah, okay, do you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay.
So, good morning. My name is Alise Hegle, and I'm happy to stand for people in the... Yeah? Oh, okay. Thanks, Lori. So, it's an honor to be here, to be able to try to shine light, do the best I possibly can on the parent perspective and really adding some reality to these issues, right? So, I am a mom who has personally navigated the child welfare system. My case was closed quite a few years ago, and again, every time I say that, it's an honor to even be able to say that, right? So I am a mom who has personally navigated practically every social system you can think of. Grew up in the, you know, juvenile justice, criminal justice, trauma, substance abuse, and a very emotional part of my life is the notion of having been homeless. I was homeless before my pregnancy, I was homeless during my pregnancy, and so I get emotional because I know what it's like to sleep out in the freezing cold. I know what it's like to run into a hospital just to try to get warm for a second, to eat somebody's apple tree, right, with a worm in it just because I'm starving. And I don't normally say those things in a presentation, but I feel like that's really important to know. Because there's real stories and there's real faces, and when we look at that data, right, it's beyond just a number. It is very hard trying to navigate a child welfare case and turn your whole entire life around, learn new healthy behaviors, you know, try to identify those, a different way of life. You know, one of our Parents for Parents programs in the state has been collecting ACEs data on child welfare families and report that 90 to 93% of the data collected report an ACEs score of 6 or above, right? I think that that's huge because it is, there's a lot of trauma involved, right? So I'm a mom. When my case was open, I had the blessing of being able to have a little over $100 cash assistance. I can say that with a smile on my face because that was what I had to work with, right? And I was grateful for that. And if it wasn't for some support from my family to be able to pay for my clean and sober house, I mean, I don't know where I would be at, because many of our families trying to even tap into an existing resource can be very challenging. I am also a contracted social service worker with the Office of Public Defense. And many of my families, you know, they'll ask me, can you come with me to this appointment? Because I should qualify, but I'm being denied, right? So there's some type of gap that occurs within the system. And then also the TANF bill, concurrent benefits, what a blessing. That was a legislation passed, what, back in 2007. Unfortunately, in my experience, the communication doesn't always occur. Some individuals, some workers, whether on either side, it's not a shaming thing, but many families, I find, you know, I might be assigned to a case 10 months in, and I'm like, oh, do you still have your TANF? And they're like, no, it never got renewed or something, right? So those types of things, it's that constant conversation that was not. I take no accountability for that. but I just say those things because some of the numbers reflected in the data, right? I would say that there would probably be a much greater percentage of families that would qualify for that, but there are some service disparities and gaps that I think that we should all be, you know, pretty aware of. So I would like to note that it is also very challenging trying to develop an economic growth, right? To have a foundation, to be in a position to where your children can be returned home to you, right? Fortunately, I was able to have working connections, child care assistance, while I was navigating, you know, TANF requirements, while I was a full-time student, while I was mentoring other families at the courthouse, right? And I say all that because that's a lot of stuff on a person's plate with still an open CPS case. And there's often many different requirements for each of those things, right? And there's really not enough time in the day to be able to navigate all that. And if it wasn't for me being the woman that I am, that learned how to use my voice, that my voice is powerful and it's valuable and I need to advocate, and if I don't ask for help, right, I'm not gonna get that answer I might need. So I was able to have some people in those different areas really, really advocating and pushing forward to make sure that I was able to be on a pathway towards success. Many of our families, it breaks my heart, they may not have developed that tool, may not think it's even in their right to be able to speak, like, hey, there's a lot of requirements here and I'm having a hard time keeping up, and may no longer be able to receive certain benefits that can get them to that point. And I feel like that's really important to say, because if I wasn't able to still be able to be on Working Connections as I received a bachelor degree, I would not be able to stand here today as a woman who just 7 years ago was homeless, and now today I somehow don't qualify for any single public assistance, right? To this day, to this day, I have no idea how that has happened. It's been a lot of work, you know? But I really feel like, you know, I also help staff the Washington State Parent Advocacy Committee, which consists of parents and child welfare stakeholders together, really partner on policy and practice. And I feel it's important to mention that many of our issues that we're very passionate about are related to this, you know, poverty, housing. We haven't even talked about housing, and I'm not gonna go on a tangent. If you know me, I will go on a housing tangent, right? Just because that is one critical component in order for children to be able to return home that a family needs to have, you know, safe and adequate, affordable housing. That is expensive and very, very hard to get, and there's certain systemic barriers. I'm happy to talk about them at another time if you're interested. but some systemic barriers that really pose another roadblock to a family being able to ensure that their children, that might have been my fault that time, that their children...
You know, I wonder if maybe you want to transfer.
I get passionate.
Let's try that mic. Let me take that one away, just so we can keep that apart.
Hello. I have fun. Housing. So I just wanted to say that, because I feel like that was also kind of a missing piece in the data, and it's an issue that our child welfare families, you know, many, many encounter. We are hoping, if there's research gurus in the room, to be able to identify some more numbers and figures related to how many children are lingering in the foster care system, because housing is the last barrier to reunification and families might not be able to achieve it. I know it's very significant for the families that I work with, and it's a very large issue for the parents on the Washington State Parent Advocacy Committee, right? So we have some voices from across the state. So I think the more that we can all be aware of that and to try to focus some concrete guidance towards that piece is important. And I just want to mention that in closing, that a couple things that I feel that parents navigating the system specifically related to poverty might want me to say, being up here, is that with the child welfare system and the intersect with poverty and child welfare, I just get to have all the fun, noisy distractions today, and that's okay, because I can run with it, right? Is that, you know, the more barriers that can be mitigated to ensure that a parent with these issues, right, navigating these things, have an opportunity to have equal ground to navigate their child welfare case, those critical things are mitigated, is essential. For instance, transportation. I love, you know, child welfare and social workers being able to ensure that bus tickets and ORCA cards, so families being able to have that access and that resource to get to their services. Sometimes there's a service disparity gap there, and so those things are critical. As well as, you know, compassion, just showing us compassion, right? It is so stressful trying, you know, I might be in court and I might not have ate that day, right? And my mood is going to be a little bit different, right? And so just being able to come from the lens that there's real voices here. It's just like my daughter, if she's tired and she hasn't ate, and I can think of that, right? I might have a little bit more compassion towards the attitude she might be giving me or something, right? And so it's just recognizing
being aware of those things, and just really, I feel that the more policy and practice that we can have that can support an individual's economic growth, please let our our families being able to achieve a higher education. And, you know, I love you guys. This is such an important issue. I'm going to definitely close because I think we're going to have, you know, questions and answers. And I hope I did an okay job with just shining some of the realities with this while speaking above lawnmowers. Thank you.
Let me see, what do I want to say here? I think the first thing I want to say, thank you to the people who put on this forum, because I don't think this subject gets the attention that it deserves. And so just a little bit. I think the child welfare system we have in the U.S. is basically shaped by the child poverty rate we have. So, you know, it's amazing to me that professionals, even scholars in this country, don't seem to read or think that much about what goes on in other countries, other developed countries in the world. But they have very different child welfare systems a lot of the time. And so how is our system different? So remember, we have child poverty rates that are 3 to 5 times rates of a lot of countries in Western Europe. And so what does that mean concretely? It means that we have a child welfare system dominated by neglect reports. And so in 2005, I published an article on this subject. And at that point, about 60% of victims substantiated in NCANs had neglect as the form of maltreatment. 10 years later, that's almost 80%. This is a system dominated by neglect. So, you know, we're really talking accurately about child welfare in the U.S. We wouldn't be talking about abuse and neglect stuff. We'd be talking about neglect and abuse. This is a neglect-related system because poverty and neglect are so enmeshed here. Well, how? Why exactly? And that's kind of what I want to talk about here. So already, some of the speakers have talked about severe poverty. And particularly when you talk around neglect, severity of poverty really makes a tremendous amount of difference. So whether families are making $20,000 a year or $10,000 a year, you know, so many of you in this room know that Marine, other people at POC in 2009 did that survey of several hundred, 800 or 900 parents in the child welfare system. At that point in time, 50% of those people on open cases in the child welfare system had incomes of $10,000 or less. You know, they're not just poor, they're destitute. So in this country, about a third to a half of child welfare families are not just poor, they're destitute. And you have to start off with that and kind of understanding why do we have the kind of the neglect-dominated system that we have here. So I think the other thing, you start talking about neglect, whether it's chronic neglect or, you know, the subject that I'm interested in and have talked about for years and years, anyone who works close to child welfare in this room, probably everyone in this room, knows it isn't just poverty, right? It's substance abuse, it's mental health problems, especially mood disorders, and it's family violence. And it's those things in combination, and a lot of the families have all of those things, all you might describe as ACEs, but they have other things as well. About 15% of the parents have cognitive impairments. You have high rates of parental incarceration. You know, you can just sort of add up the socioeconomic disadvantages of the populations here, and then you start adding these other things. Substance abuse, mental health disorders, family violence on top of that. So what's the connection there? What's the connection between poverty and those other things that dominate our child welfare systems? Not only this state, but all over the country. So this is one thing that I would hope that we would have scholars in the room would eventually give us some very clear answers to this. But let me tell you the ones that I think are available now. And there isn't going to be a single pathway here, you know. So sometimes when I do training, I ask people to try to describe the causal pathways between poverty, substance abuse, mental health disorders, and family violence. And you hear all kind of answers here. And you know, so the answer that I want to offer here is just the pathway, particularly to kind of chronic neglect, is I think through early experiences of poverty and trauma in childhood, early onset mental health disorders, substance abuse beginning in adolescence or early adulthood, and you add family violence as kind of the icing on the cake with a lot of the families that we deal with. Now, that isn't going to be the only pathway from poverty to child welfare, but for the very serious cases in our system, many of the kids in foster care, many of the kids who are multiply maltreated, it's going to be that from combinations of poverty and trauma to mental health disorders, particularly depression, and PTSD, of course, and then family violence on top. So I want you to think for a second to me, well, why are these things so connected? Why should it be like this? And so I want you to think for a second about what does it mean actually to be destitute? What does it mean to actually be poor? And I guess the emphasis, you know, you can talk about stress or toxic stress. That probably is right. To me, it's kind of superficial, but it's not wrong. But if you kind of want to understand what's going on there with a lot of the families is that people are losing power over their life circumstances. Now, of course, that's what poverty does to you. So imagine for a second you're driving over here today and you have a flat tire. Almost everyone in this room calls AAA. Someone comes and fixes that in an hour. You have a credit card. You get your car fixed. You're off. What? You don't have AAA. You don't have a credit card. You don't have a car. You don't have anywhere to get anywhere. You don't have any money. What do you do at that point? You know, that's the situation that the extremely poor people in this country are in, right? So you start off with the loss of power over life circumstances. That's partly economic. Think about depression. Rates of depression, 2 to 3 times rates for poor people compared to people who are not poor. What goes on in depression? One of the things that starts to happen is people literally lose control of their own bodies. You know, read really eloquent accounts of depression in the Noonday Demon, the Andrew Solomon book, great book, I recommend that. Or in other books, paralysis, literally immobility, is a very common effect of major depression. You start to lose control over your own body. Substance abuse, you lose control of your own choices, your own ability to make good choices for yourself. And the same thing with family violence. So to give an example here, think about the populations that have elevated rates of depression. So start off with the elderly. Think about, of course, the poor, elevated rates of depression, people with trauma histories, people on the bottom of hierarchies. So what do all those groups have in common? You know, so can I ask this? So I think the common ingredient there, of course, is powerlessness here. The common ingredient, particularly in the serious cases, are powerlessness. And this is why, of course, the treatment issues, the therapeutic issues, are so incredibly difficult here. So I guess, I don't know how much time I have here, but just a couple of minutes here on some sort of idea about the interventions here, right? So if you think about, well, there's going to be a population of people, and Leroy Pelton is probably going to talk about this, you know, and he's very eloquent on the subject. There's just a whole bunch of people we can help with poverty-related services. We don't need, you know, when you talk about families, you know, this Eden and Schaefer book, the $2 a day book that some of you have read, and I wrote a sounding board about, that's 4% of American children living in families and have $2 a day a person, those kind of families. For those families, more money is the intervention. That's what you do. When you have severely poor people, you give them a concrete resource, right? That's the first and foremost thing to be doing, whether it's $1,500, $2,500, whatever it is, right? As people get to make a little bit more money and they have housing and their basic needs are kind of covered, then of course you have to have interventions that really do deal with substance abuse and with mental health disorders. So the kind of the low-hanging fruit here, it seems like to me in child welfare and the prevention world as well, is depression screening. So I just want to say that depressive disorders have a tremendous causal influence in child welfare that's not adequately recognized even by scholars. So particularly when you start thinking about, well, what do we do about severe depression? You know, and of course a lot of that has to do with cognition, not just with feeling down or lack of energy, but with a lack of hope. You know, that's the underlying meaning of a lot of those very severe depressive kind of disorders there. And then there is, of course, is going to be a group of people here where you really do need to build their parenting skills, right? So there isn't going to be, I guess what I'm trying to say, a single intervention for all the poor people that we have in child welfare systems here. There's going to be layered interventions. But what do we need more of, just to start off with? We need more concrete services. We need a better safety nets. So all over the country in the last few years, you know, foster care going up, we have a whole bunch of states in the country that are reducing, basically knocking the foundation out from under their social safety nets and then wondering why foster care goes up. You know, hey, you know, the 4-year-old would say, duh, You know, how hard is it to figure this out? I mean, you just don't have to do dumbass things, right? You can actually do smart things with your public policy kind of thing, right? From the standpoint of building us kind of a safety net here. So it's the other thing I want to say in terms of better outcomes. It is never going to be totally a matter of just some child welfare interventions here. We really do have to think about TANF. So the thing that shocked me about these statistics that we saw early on is what a small percentage of the families are on TANF. There cannot not be any way that is justifiable. Or what a small percentage of families are receiving food benefits. That just says we have an awful lot of people in child welfare who are eligible for benefits that they are not receiving. So we can start off there. We don't necessarily need to have $50 million. Let's just get people the benefits that they actually deserve under state law, just as a kind of a starter there. And finally, we do have to have some programs that do have combinations of things. That is, they have poverty-related services, they have substance abuse, they have mental health kind of services, they have family violence, crisis intervention kind of services, and they put it together in some kind of a package. Right? So there's going to be a population of families where we have to have all of the above, but that's not all of the families. We have significant percentage of families that we can help just with poverty-related services, or with parenting education classes, or simply with a fairly brief course of mental health treatment around depression. There are those kind of families there. And then we have the more intractable ones where it's going to take a lot more. So I think with that, I'll stop.
Okay, Leroy?
Yes?
Can you hear me? Okay, would you like to do your part here?
Okay. I'm sorry that I've been trying hard to listen to all these presentations, and I wish I could have heard them better. So I'm sort of at a deficit here because I wasn't hearing them too well. A lot of us very interested wanted to hear them better, but this is the nature of it. So I'll just give my comments then on the relation between poverty and child abuse and neglect that historically, going back as far as we could go, there's always been a very strong relationship between poverty and child abuse and neglect and poverty and involvement in the child welfare system. This across every state. Since I've been in child welfare since 1970s, it's been true. There's been no stronger relationship with any factor with child abuse and neglect than poverty. And so one question, of course, is what is the nature of this relationship? How is poverty evolved? And I have to stress that we think of this in a unicausal way, that just the terms child abuse and neglect means is a parent, in a sense, guilty of abuse or neglect? Is he or she the cause of it or not? And if we answer yes, then we say we have a child abuse and neglect case. But still today, after so much research and so much literature on this, we overlook the fact that the overwhelming number of child abuse and neglect cases and events are multiply caused. There's almost always multiple causation involved. That is, there's an interaction between the parents' abilities or inabilities, and the surrounding environment, a dangerous home environment where there's peeling lead paint, or there's no window guards on the windows, or the stove has to be lit in order to get heat in the house, and so forth. Of course, there's a lot of environmental factors involved. And so if we talk about prevention, if we really want to focus on prevention, we have to focus on not only the parent, but also the parent's environment. I've come to the conclusion over the years that a major way of looking at child abuse and neglect is that parents who are unable, who are least able to cope with poverty, are the ones who are most likely to be involved in abuse and neglect or be reported to child welfare agencies. Many parents living in poverty are better able to cope. They know how to get their resources, to gather it to themselves. They know how to protect their children in a dangerous neighborhood, in a dangerous environment. They're good supervisors of the children. But people like myself who live in a middle-class home, well, there's not that much dangers around for the child within the home. So I don't need the same ability to prevent harm to the children as the parents living in poverty do. So it's the least able to parents or those who are most vulnerable to charges of neglect. They have a low ability to cope with poverty, and they're most in need of help. And yet, we're often more into judging whether they're guilty of neglect or abuse rather than actually helping them like we would any, say, a handicapped person living in a house. We would help him fix up his house in ways that he's able to get around better. We would compensate for his disability. But we don't look at abusing and neglecting parents that way because already we're accusing them of something, and so we don't think they're worthy of the help. And so most of the services that we do give are in the direction of trying to change the parent rather than to offer them material help, the daycare that they need, help against these other factors I've mentioned, and so these are the connections. And what I'm very disappointed in is that over all these years, we haven't gotten better in looking at the social context in housing homeless parents rather than putting their children in foster care. Many children in foster care come from homeless families. We want to say, we see how bad the TANF program is. It's hardly giving any support to poor people anymore. I mean, it never did, but I'm thinking back to the inadequate AFDC program was better than what TANF is doing. And so if we want to think on large scale social welfare, we have to think of a basic income, a social dividend that would be given to all people besides services. And we're not providing the strong safety net that a wealthy country like ours can do from its commonwealth. The commonwealth is being ripped off by wealthy people and by industries who are taking more than their share of what belongs to them out of the commonwealth. But I don't want to go further into that. I've written about this, about the commonwealth and how it should be shared more fairly. But I do want to get into this point, which is that often in child welfare, we say, oh yes, maybe we need a stronger safety net, but that's outside of the realm of our business in child welfare and child protection agencies. And so that when I say that, well, we need to get this family housing, or we need to improve their housing, or repair their housing, the response, I think it'll be familiar to you, is sometimes people say, no, well, CPS is not a housing agency. We give social services. Social services is not interpreted or defined as meaning concrete material resources, as well as services designed to change the parent in some way. And recently, the thought came to me that, of course, I've always said that our child protection agency, our child welfare agency, is going way back in time in the United States. Have always been foster care agencies. Just look at the budget. How much of the money, how much of the time and effort of workers is gone toward foster care in one way or another, paying for it, recruiting for it, and so forth, placement decisions. And yet, I would say they're foster care agencies, but what came to me is that what we really could say is, in fact, CPS is a housing agency. This is what child welfare agencies are. They're housing agencies. They're housing children in foster care and paying for it and subsidizing it. And now, more and more, they're subsidizing adoptions. Over 50,000 adoptions a year coming out of the foster care system. So between the adoption subsidies and the foster care subsidies and maintenance of that system, CPS is a housing agency. The problem is, it's not directing its resources for housing toward families and making it possible for children to stay with their parents and their families rather than going into foster care. Now, when you look at the sums of money we're paying, it's often no more costly than to pay the rent for a homeless family to put them in a house, rather than to take, say, two children from them and put them in foster care month after month. But we're not thinking that way. The system is not thinking that way, and so what happens now is that we think we have only 400,000 children in foster care, but since around the year 2000 or so, and as a result of the Adoption Safe Families Act of 1997, we've been putting over 50,000 children nationwide in adoption every year. So when you add up on any given day the 400,000 children in America in foster care, plus the children living in subsidized adoptions through child welfare on any given day, we have over 1 million children, mostly poor, almost all poor children, living in foster care or adoption, being housed there, while we continue to remove children from homes that could be easily been safeguarded. To some extent, they would have been wonderful homes, perfect homes, but we could have gotten around the need to put them in foster care by putting the same amount of resources into housing families, into family preservation, protecting the children through family preservation, protecting them from being split up from their families and the trauma that causes, and living elsewhere and often going through one, two, three homes or more. I'll just conclude by saying, it's depressing being in the field for so long and not seeing us change our directions when the direction we've been going in is failing overall. I'll leave it at that.
My name is Esther Wanjie here. I'm a social worker. I work in South King County. I work in a particularly diverse office in the 98118 zip code. We have very special challenges. In addition to poverty, we have language and we have we just have very limited resources. And what CPS has become, we have become a house where everybody wants us to solve a problem that we don't have a solution for. We want to focus on child safety, but what do you want us to focus on? You want us to give mental health treatment. You want us to do chemical dependency. You want us to do parenting. I mean, we can't be able to focus on our core task if we are being charged with doing everything else. A child removed from our office could be anywhere, not in King County, transitioning into multiple homes. And what do these parents experience when we come into their home and take their child? They experience isolation. What do people do when they hear, oh, CPS was at your house? Do people come running to offer you support? You know? And so as we think about these numbers, we're thinking that we've not just isolated a child, we've isolated parents. You know, we've not given them safe havens for them. We've not surrounded them with healthy communities. And in addition to that, we are also having very high expectations. On that same day that we come to take your child, we also hand you, you know, a court order. And these are the stipulations. We're expecting you to understand our timelines, and you don't have a shared meaning of what our timelines mean. So within 30 days, we want certain things. And the timeline just keeps going and going. So poverty has everything to do with it, because we are asking you to be at certain places, and you can't be at certain places because maybe you don't have a car. Or in in-home cases where I work, I'm asking parents, so let's say, for example, it's a sexual abuse case, and we're asking that the person who committed that abuse to move out of their home. What is the financial implication of a safety plan? Do we consider that? You know, so let's say it was a two-parent household with three kids, and father was a breadwinner, and we are asking him, because he's the one who cannot be in the household safely, for these children to continue to live in this household with their mother, this person has to be out. Who can sustainably pay for two houses? The connection continues. So say a person is not, you know, so they don't meet the income limit. And we want these children to be in childcare so that mom can go to chemical dependency and mental health. We're not in a place where we can offer that unless we have out-of-home orders. So our money has been taken away. We are so strapped that I can only provide that for a maximum of 90 days so that a family could participate in treatment. Is it sustainable to expect people to sustain the gains that they get for a short period of 90 days to not have another intake? Are those realistic expectations? So, yeah, we have great programs, but the great programs are not responsive to the need at hand. We have great research, and you've presented a lot of great research, but does it match the context within which it is practiced? And I think that's the big question. There has to be a more, not a long connection, what do I call it, short? What's the opposite? No.
Seamless.
Yes. A seamless connection between the services that are being offered, the context within they are being offered, and how they could be posed to be an advantage to the families involved in child welfare. So, and in addition to that, we're just talking about poverty. We're not even talking about disproportionality. How does that even play into that? So what does health look like in certain families that differs from
another family, it's health, but is there one model of health? Is there a universal, uniform health that we can pose it and put it up on a tripod and say, this is health, and this is what it should look like? And how do we capture the strengths and weaknesses of families? So there are many, many, many challenges. If a family has used up all of their TANF benefits, we have nothing more to offer them. And that's the point when they're interacting with us, where their money, their resource has run out. I don't know, there's nothing extra to offer them other than they could go to the food bank, but the food bank, some of the houses that they live in have electric bills for over 450. It's not just affordable housing. It's affordable housing with affordable utilities, with affordable transportation, affordable all round. We just can't compartmentalize what's affordable. We have to encompass all of what's affordable. What do families need to successfully navigate the child welfare system? We try to create shared meaning. We do. We give them our timelines, we give them our expectations, but our expectations do not encompass the challenges which they are experiencing. For that shift to happen from whatever it is that brought them to our attention to health, there are a lot of barriers. And so far we've had some success, but we've not had the type of success that we would like to have. And so I'm calling on all of you to reach out to people and give them meaningful solutions. You know, so I'm thinking of myself, for example. I'm here and I have at least three people that I can count on that if I'm here and my child needs to be picked up from childcare, three people immediately can do that with no constraints. What do families in child welfare have? Who are their three people? And there are three people that they are calling on are probably impacted by the same level of poverty. So I wish I would give you good news, but we have a big job. We have a big job. And child safety is everyone's responsibility. It takes a village, and we are the village. So let's answer the call respectfully, honorably, and proactively.
Thank you very much, panelists. I want to check in with you on the time here. We're probably about 10 minutes behind schedule. You're scheduled for a break at 10:45, and we do need to resume at 11 o'clock to give our next panelists the time that they deserve. How many people are interested in a break? How many people would be okay with a 5 to 7 minute as opposed to 15 minute break? Does that sound okay? Okay, so let's plan on that. We'll take about 10 minutes. We won't limit the time you have to ask questions of our presenters and our panelists, but we will take a shorter break to get back here on time. And if you would, please make an effort to be back in the room, sitting in your chairs at 11 o'clock, ready to go. Okay, so what I'm going to suggest is that I'll walk to you. If you have a question, please raise your hand high. We do have somebody who is participating, obviously, by Skype, and so it's difficult for him to hear. So if you would talk loudly and speak into the microphone, that would be very much appreciated. So questions, feel free to ask anything of our presenters or our panelists. Any questions? Somebody to start us off?
Yeah,
If you would, just say your name and what organization you represent.
Sure. Hi, my name is Wendy Harris, and I work with King County's Developmental Disabilities Division. Thank you. This is really powerful and deep. And I wanted to share something that I've learned in the past year participating in the Child Welfare Early Learning Partnership and also talking to folks who work at that birth point. So for an upper income family who has experienced substance abuse during pregnancy and not using Medicaid, the child, they may have even reported to their healthcare provider that they were using substances, but because that clinic has no social worker in the clinic necessarily, nobody ever makes a referral to CPS. That child isn't tracked at birth, there's no tox screen done, and the child doesn't land in the child welfare system, maybe ever, just because of how the healthcare system works, right? But for a low-income child or family, they're going to end up with a tox screen and an immediate referral. And what I've observed is the kids who are white are generally sent home, even though there's a referral, and the kids of color are placed out of home right away from birth, and sort of increasing the chances of trauma from being in the system. So I'm just, it feels like this issue, I don't know how many people have read The New Jim Crow, but that those three possible birth points that you were talking about, it feels like The New Jim Crow is applied at birth. Nobody's talking about disproportional race outcomes that interface with poverty outcomes. And I'm just wondering if anybody can speak to that.
Any of our panelists, presenters, want to speak to that question, that issue?
Which one, the first one or the second one? The disproportionality?
You choose, Dee. You start us off.
Well, I'm certainly not going to talk for the child welfare system here around what happens with prenatal substance abuse. I mean, even when I was in the system, I felt that child welfare responses were very erratic to that. I think it was very unpredictable what's actually going to happen in terms of report or so forth. I guess I would just have to say in terms of, and I think the likelihood that low-income people of color are going to be reported, I think that's probably accurate in large cities, probably. The extent to which, if you think about, well, what would a more humane system be? It would seem like to me that we would want some kind of voluntary outreach to substance abusing women who are identified during pregnancy, not based on coercion, but based on a voluntary offer of services. And that ought to be a public policy goal in Washington State to actually try to achieve that. So the idea would be that if families are vulnerable, if they have obvious kind of risk factors, and chemical dependency is one of those, the idea should be that the CPS system is never, and I want to repeat that, never the first point of contact with that family. The public policy goal should be that there should be some other resource system that reaches out to the family before the CPS system has to. And I think that ought to be the ideal here. Now, just a couple of other comments here, just something on the issue of race and poverty and so forth, right? So I think the thing that, again, back to issues around severe poverty, I think probably rates of poverty in the African-American community might be 50% at least higher than they are among whites. I mean, probably at least that. And even more concerning is rates of long-term severe poverty. So if you look at who are poor over a long period of time in this country, poor longer than 5 years, that is overwhelmingly African-American compared to whites. So I think there are very definitely social justice issues there.
Good, thank you. Another question.
Can I speak to that question?
Quickly, yes.
Yeah, very quickly.
Let me give you a mic.
On the issue of racial proportionality, I can't speak for Children's Administration, but I do know that they are working on it, and I think their goal is so that race does not statistically predict involvement in the child welfare system. From economic services perspective, recently, as of October, We have added to our strategic plan that we are going to look for ways to measure and address any racial disparities that exist in terms of underrepresentation for our programs to promote equal access, and that's something that's going to be on our agenda going forward.
And if I could just say one thing, in our work with advocating for, this is a huge issue, disproportionality, and so I just want to note, I love that CA also adopted the racial equity analysis tool that can be used, prior to actually implementing a program or a practice, and I would love to see that uniformed across our state. Part of it was adopted through Washington State Policy and like the King County Disproportionality Committee, but I think it's essential that those that are impacted are able to be at the table and like, how are these issues going to impact me? For instance, the qualification for a family to be able to qualify for housing through coordinated entry, literally homeless, meaning you're on the streets or you're in a car. Well, you know what? I can't stay clean if I'm on the streets or I'm sleeping in a car, right? So automatically, I'm at a disadvantage for that piece. And so I just want to note that really second that, because that's a huge piece. And I am one of those moms who, was in and out of jail while pregnant. That would be a great place to talk to me, right? And provide some hope, because I didn't have any hope, right? So I really want to second that notion that there's other points of contact to where, these issues can be, discussed and highlighted, so.
I'm Mary Ann Murphy. I'm from Spokane, and it's a real bummer to see you all, because I left working in the child welfare system 5 years ago, and it seems like you're stuck in the same places. I have admired Dr. Leroy Pelton forever. He has told us 30 years ago what is the right thing to do. Dee Wilson has told us our whole lives what is the right thing to do. So what is it with all you guys? We are actually poor in Spokane. If you noted the map that we have the poorest legislative district, that's the third, that's where I live. And really, Seattle, you're rich, it's precious, come on. Every one of you here should really examine your conscience. It's always been the twin evils of poverty and racism. They are intertwined. So why even talk about them separately? And, get going, guys. I have to go to another meeting.
We have time for one more question. If you would agree.
I'm Mary Helen Roberts. I pretend to be retired, but I keep coming to things like this. And I work on mostly children of the incarcerated. And I have to confess that this is more a comment than a question, but I do think, since the issues of poverty and race and the new Jim Crow have been raised, that we need to start including in both our data and our thoughts the impact that the criminal justice system has on both poverty and on the child welfare system. And it is even more blatantly racially disproportionate than other aspects. So. And then I'm also going to follow up on Marianne's pitch of you got to do something, is that we are the people who are going to be the foundation of changing public policy. And all too often, we allow parts of this, particularly like the criminal justice system, to be off our agenda. And particularly since an election year is coming up, I think we're going to think about that.
Okay. Great. I think let's go ahead and take our break just to give sufficient time for people to use the restroom if you'd like. Do come back and be back in your seats by 11. Okay, so that we stay on schedule, I'm going to start again. I will kind of forego summary comments from the first session before taking time away from our panelists in the second session. So let me just start by introducing the panel, but first giving you a sense of what they will speak to. There are a few primary questions that our panelists are asked now to reflect on. One of them is, what are the viable poverty reduction strategies in our state?
What are the costs and benefits of various poverty reduction strategies? And how do policies address issues around racial equity and disparities? So let me go ahead and introduce our panel. I'll start with Professor Maureen Lucenko, who is another colleague of mine at the School of Social Work. Next to her is Professor Bob Plotnick, who is with the Evans School of Public Policy and Governance. Next to Bob is Tony Lee of the Statewide Poverty Action Network. And Lori Finst is from the Washington State Budget and Policy Center. So I think Professor Plotnick, Bob Plotnick, will start us off with a broad framing, and then we'll take it from there.
Well, good morning, folks, and thank you for inviting me to participate in this. So we thought it might be useful to set out a broad, say, framework of major strategies for reducing poverty. And I'll talk about that briefly, but no more than 5 minutes, really. And then each of the other panelists will present, talk about their specific ideas about poverty strategy, anti-poverty strategies. And at the end, I may make a few other comments if I thought there's an issue that I wanted to raise that they didn't get to. So one way to think about reducing strategies for reducing poverty is three broad approaches. You can try to prevent poverty in the sense of increasing market income, increasing earnings, so that people don't need to rely on income support. The second is to supplement private earnings, that is income support programs like TANF, like SNAP, and so forth. And the third is to mitigate the consequences of being raised in poverty, so for the giving the next generation a better shot at making it. And these are not mutually exclusive categories. In many ways, they complement each other. Some programs fall into more than one category. For example, the Earned Income Tax Credit is both a work inducement, but it also is a very, very important income supplement. And I guess I'd also maybe mention on the prevention side, another strand that some people think about is trying to reduce the prevalence of families that are very high risk of being poor. And that's going to come down to basically dealing with single-parent families in an effective way. That's basically what I want to say, but I also just wanted to draw your attention to this report that came out yesterday. It is called Opportunity, Responsibility, and Security, a Consensus Plan for Reducing Poverty and Restoring the American Dream. What makes it interesting is that it's a bipartisan effort by liberal progressive scholars at the Brookings Institution and conservative scholars at the American Enterprise Institute to come up with a set of serious proposals that could be politically viable, maybe. And it's got lots of ideas in here. No one will agree with all of them, but probably all of us will agree with some of them. And I think it was a very interesting effort to try to lay out an agenda that maybe we could coalesce around. So if that's of interest to you, you can find it on the Brookings Institute's website. And with that, I'll turn it over to my colleagues.
Thank you, Bob. I'm going to talk about economic disconnection, and Jennie talked a bit about how we came to this topic. The genesis of this project was the 2008 survey that we did of over 800 families in the child welfare system. And as Dee pointed out, we found out that 50% of the families had an income of less than $10,000 a year. But another factor that really struck me, having done this work for a long time in the field, is the low participation rate in TANF. We've seen a precipitous drop in the number of families who are receiving TANF benefits. But that was not being picked up by or being filled in by work. So we had this 20% of the families in our survey who had neither work nor TANF. And we were all scratching our heads with, well, how are these families managing? So at that point, we reached out to Jennie and other colleagues, Jen Hook, who was at POC at the time, and Joanne Lee, who was a doc student at the time, and Jiyoung King, who was still a doc student. So we looked at the surveys to see what we could learn about this 20% of the families from our survey, and it was a unique opportunity because they're face-to-face surveys with families. It's not administrative data, it's really talking with families, but it didn't have this focus because we didn't go into it thinking about when we're thinking about poverty, but there are all these other issues that families are confronted with. But we found that disconnected families had much higher housing needs and much higher needs for food than any of the other families in the survey. They were less likely to participate in SNAP, so not only were they not receiving TANF, but they weren't getting SNAP benefits either, or housing benefits, or medical services. It was off the chart as far as participation or the need for medical services. This was a group of families who had very high need for medical help. They were more likely to get help from family and friends, but those of you who are, most of you who are working in the child welfare system, we know that families don't have deep pockets. So they may have been getting some help, but it's not a lot of help. They tended to be younger, which means that they had younger children, so it goes to the comment another person made, that Wendy made earlier. They had higher rates of self-reported substance abuse, and they reported lower investment in child welfare. They didn't think that child welfare was going to help them out. This is an important factor because in other work that we've done, we found that investment in child welfare is related to reunification. So that was point in time. We went out, we talked to families, we said, you know, what are you getting, what kinds of services are you getting, and what do you need? And so what we, our sort of next generation of studies was bringing together the administrative data, TANF, child welfare, unemployment insurance, and SSI, to find out sort of what is the trajectory, how do people end up in this position of being economically disconnected, and how did it relate to their child welfare involvement. And we found out there's actually a lot of volatility. People aren't always disconnected, for the most part, or always connected, that they're going in and out of these sort of statuses. And we found that there were actually about 8 different trajectories, which I won't bore you with right now. But the really important finding here was that for families who lost benefits at the time of removal, they were less likely to reunify. And those who remained connected, and actually some families did get connected at the time of removal, they were much more likely to reunify. So there's this relationship between access to either work or TANF or SSI that is related to reunification down the road. And what's really important also is that we know that when families come into the system and children are removed, the plan is usually reunification. So it's hard to predict who's going to reunify and who's not, just on, you know, right at the very initial removal of a child. So I'm going to talk a little bit about implications. And there are very smart people in this room, and there are very smart people out there in the field. So I hope that you will engage with us around this issue. I think it's really important that the data that's been shared today be widely distributed in the field. It should be no secret. And we should be keeping track of it over time. Because we have seen a drop in TANF participation. We should be monitoring this. And Diaz recommended this in the past. Jennie and I have been out doing focus groups with child welfare and TANF workers. There are committed people with good ideas. We ought to be bringing all ideas to the table. Coordination across child welfare and TANF, and this is about practice. I don't know, it may even be a policy, that there are requirements for TANF participation, and there are lots of requirements and mandated services in child welfare. And TANF can count the mandated service participation towards TANF receipt. So that's happening. We heard that in the field. We've heard that from economic services. That, in addition to more coordination between child welfare and TANF, so that this idea of a seamless opportunity for families connect with services can actually be more of a reality. Many of, and most of the child welfare, most of the TANF offices are actually co-located with child welfare, so there's real opportunities there. Greater use back. This is a really important point, so I want to make sure that we get it. This issue of the concurrent benefit. This is something that I think we could increase, and this would be fairly easy to do. Instead of opting into it, you could opt out of it. So families coming into the who have their children removed could get this benefit unless reunification wasn't the plan. So it really depends on the concurrent benefit requires that the child welfare worker who's got all kinds of things on her plate is also attending to this. So it could be possible, for instance, to opt out of concurrent benefits. The other thing I think we could do, and it wouldn't require a lot, is when a family comes into the system, having a screen around, you know, sort of economic or financial resources, and then getting families, as Dee said, connected to what they're eligible for. So these are just some, you know, maybe pragmatic things that could be done. They're not really big ideas, but they're ideas that sort of flow from the data. So thank you very much, and I appreciate your time.
I just wanted to make a couple of quick comments following what Professor Lucenko here said. You know, it really is appalling that people are not receiving these benefits because in theory, aside from TANF, and I can address TANF much later, but aside from TANF, you know, people should be eligible for SNAP or food stamps. There's absolutely no reason why, you know, if their children were removed or anything else, they should lose their SNAP benefits. You know, maybe their benefits will change, but there's no reason for that. There is no reason for them not to be on medical care service, on Medicaid, okay? Many of you may know that Medicaid prior to the Affordable Care Act used to be tied to what we call categorical eligibility. In other words, you have to be on TANF, you have to have children, you have to be disabled. Now with the Medicaid expansion up to 138% of the federal poverty level, there is no reason why low-income parents or low-income adults without children should not be on Medicaid, okay? And we've had the most generous Medicaid program for children, up to 300% of the federal poverty level. You pay on the sliding scale above, I believe it's 200 or 250, I think it's above 250, right? You have to pay a little bit. And undocumented children can be on our Medicaid program for kids. So there is absolutely really no reason, and it's really appalling to me that, you know, that these families are not accessing these benefits or losing their benefits, you know, when their children are removed, or I don't know what the process, when that happens. But again, I just wanted to make sure those of you who work in the field know that we have a very, I wouldn't say very generous, but a pretty good child care system that allows eligibility up to 200% of the federal poverty level, which is more generous than a lot of other states. Hopefully, you know, we can raise that to 300% of the federal poverty level to eliminate what we call the cliff effect, you know, where people lose their benefits if they make $5 more. But I think if we were able to raise that to about 300% of the federal poverty level, on sort of a sliding scale, fee scale, I think that would solve that problem. So I'll turn it over to Lori.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Lori Fingst. I'm with the Washington State Budget and Policy Center. Stand up. And we are an organization that works to advance prosperity for all Washingtonians. And It's a privilege to be here for a lot of reasons, but what is inspiring to me is that there are policy people, practitioners, there are parents in the room, there are academics, and that we're all in here together trying to figure this out and connect the dots. And my background is in poverty and income inequality. It's what I spent the entire time in grad school studying. And I know that academics understand the connection between those dots, but the policy world doesn't always understand those connections. So to me, this is an inspiring event, and I'm seeing many, many more of them around the country and all the places I go, that there's really a movement to connect these dots and a frustration that we haven't made more progress given that we are the wealthiest nation in the world. So this is, it's wonderful to be here. I think, you know, I have some comments, just that's really just a summary of what's already been said this morning, and then I'll talk about the two-generation framework, which DSHS talked about earlier, and I'm thrilled to connect with you after this, to really bring the policy and the program stuff together, and how can we work together to make that happen. But I keep, every time I do a talk like this, I'm reminded of this one statement, which is, a system is designed to produce the results it gets. And you've probably all heard that before. And so that reverberates in my mind anytime I do a talk, that the results that we're getting in child welfare are really, the system is producing those results. And our economic system is producing the high rate of poverty that we have in the United States. And I walked in late, but I'm sure Jennie talked about that it's not really poverty, but we should be focusing on at least 200% of the federal poverty line if we really want to make a dent in economic hardship. So at the Budget and Policy Center, because we focus on the state budget, poverty and income inequality underlies everything that I do. So while that's my background, I necessarily work in connecting the dots between child welfare, health, education, criminal justice, increasingly climate change, huge looming threat with big poverty and income inequality implications and huge budget implications. So to me, this is the issue for so much of what we do in the state budget and the investments that we should be making. So just to recap, probably what Jennie already talked about, one in three of our kids live below 200% of the federal poverty line. And the rate of low-income kids in our state increased by 5 full percentage points since 2008. And it went down 1 percentage point this last year, but it has stayed really high historically. So we haven't really made a dent even since the recession, which actually says a lot. 6 in 10 Latino, Black, American Indian, and Alaskan Native children are living below 200% of the federal poverty line. If you break down the Asian and Pacific Islander category, many ethnicities within the Asian Pacific Islander category have rates as high as 8 in 10, living below that 200% threshold. So, you know, when people talk about poverty, they talk about personal failure. And this is not personal failure, this is systemic failure, that so many of our children are living under conditions with economic hardship. And because this is a systemic failure, we need a systemic solution to do something about it. And, you know, our programs, I think social programs, social benefit programs, they catch a lot of heat because our poverty measure does such a bad job of measuring their impact. But we know with the use of the supplemental poverty measure that 2 years ago, I haven't seen the latest data, but 241,000 kids were kept out of poverty through the programs that we invest in. So our programs are working, they could just be working much better. And we know that from the international data, that if you look at our peer nations, mostly in Western Europe, other industrialized capitalist societies, they start out sometimes with higher poverty rates, but they do a far better job of reducing poverty when you look at transfer programs. So, you know, I'm not of the mindset that we could, that our economy could absolutely end poverty, but I know for sure that we could be doing a lot more investing to reduce it considerably. And just as, just because I'm not sure how many people are familiar with the state budget, does anyone know exactly how much we spend in terms of our economic programs? Out of the entire state operating budget, does anyone have a sense of the share that is going to the programs that are actually trying to mitigate and reduce poverty?
I can get the total dollar amount is roughly $2 billion over the biennium, but yeah. I could not quote what percentage that represents.
Yeah. Well, and this is just the operating budget, but it's 4%. Four? Did you say? I didn't hear you. Excellent job. Yeah. 4% of the entire operating budget. So this idea that we're like wasting a lot of money on social programs. that we need to trim the fat. That's just not the case. A very small percentage of our budget actually goes to the programs that reduce poverty. And Tony's going to talk about this in a little bit. But notably, if you just look at the recession, almost all those dollars are discretionary, meaning that in tough times, they're also the first programs to be cut. So if you just look at the TANF program, since 2010, over $600 million was cut from that program during the recession. So we essentially started balancing the budget in Washington State on the backs of low-income people. So I think about these costs a lot when we work on, you know, what could we actually do about this from a policy standpoint? And thanks to Bob Plotnick, who I took many, many courses from while I was in grad school, I'm always reminded of a study by Harry Holzer at Georgetown, who talks about the economic costs of growing up poor. And he only looked at three things. He looked at the foregone earnings of a child who grows up in poverty compared to a child who grows up with a family that has a median income. He looked at the higher likelihood of getting involved with the criminal justice system and the increased costs of poor health outcomes as an adult and medical expenditures. And so at the time, this is back in 2007, he discovered through his research that just those three things, health, criminal justice, and earnings, thank you, was 3.8% of GDP. So if back in 2007, that was $500 billion a year annually in the United States, that otherwise would be going into the economy. If you fast forward to now, that is $660 billion, and Washington State's share of that, given how many people we have, children we have in poverty, is $11.7 billion a year lost to our economy annually. So certainly, if you look at that versus what we're spending in our 4% and $2 billion, certainly the cost of investing to do something about this would far outweigh the benefits. I'm sorry, the benefits of investing. Okay, so with that in mind, I'll just quickly, if I'm okay on time? Okay. So we've been working with a number of partners on trying to come up with a two-generation policy framework. Several of them are in the room. Lori Lippold and I have been working. We often text at 2 a.m. about this. If you guys know Lori, you know that that's how she operates. Just kind of have a roll with it. Tony is a part of a stakeholder group that we've been a part of. So we've been really on this, you know, two-gen kind of wave that is happening across the country. And, you know, it's the two-gen stuff is not necessarily new. It is gaining a lot of traction. And, you know, just at the heart of it, it's really just the idea that to alleviate poverty, policies and programs need to address the needs of children and adults simultaneously, and not separate in silos like we tend to do. So we have an early learning system that works really well with kids, but not necessarily families. We have a workforce development system that's really great for adults, but not so much the kids. So the two-gen strategy is really trying to blend and braid different funding streams, different programs, and how can we really center the family? Also, the way we measure our outcomes, how can we center it on the family? And do our work differently so we see a different result, because the results that we see across any social program to alleviate poverty are really inadequate by any standard. So there are programs across the country that are working on 2Gen. I was really happy to hear DSHS talking about it this morning. The basic components are pretty simple, and again, this is that systemic approach. Our early childhood and education programs are an inherent part of it, and Head Start is probably one of the oldest 2Gen models that we have. Post-secondary and employment pathways and the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act that was passed in 2014 with strong bipartisan support in Congress offers an amazing opportunity to embed opportunities for low-income parents and their kids. Wealth building, economic assets, financial planning, all of that stuff is another really important bucket. Health and well-being of the overall family, and then social capital, which is probably one of the hardest things to measure, but what a lot of researchers and policymakers kind of call the secret sauce, like the personal networks that people are a part of that need to weave through all of those things I just mentioned. So those are the basic buckets. You know, there I have data on programs that have emerged around the country in Minnesota, in Connecticut, in Utah. They passed 2-gen legislation that basically created a body of in the legislature to be, or I'm sorry, in the governor's office to be accountable to intergenerational poverty, to measure it in a different way, and to have the results that everybody wants guide the decision making, the policy, and where that meets the programs. So, you know, we have specific policy recommendations, which maybe we'll get into. I'm going to stop there. But just, you know, we can do things differently. We need to listen to parents when we do that. They are the customer in this, and because they live in poverty, we often think that they don't deserve to be heard, but that is what's missing in our policy and program development. So thank you.
Bob, before you get started, I wonder if you could interject some ideas around cost-benefit analyses or cost-benefit studies with respect to poverty reduction programs. I know that that's an area that you've dabbled in quite a bit, and I think it might be helpful as we're thinking about, you know, forward-looking kinds of strategies.
Sure. But I'm an economist, so I can talk about benefits and costs, I suppose. You know, the basic idea of benefit cost analysis, it's a term that's loosely used, is really quite simple. You look at the benefits of a program, and that's broadly conceived to the participants and to the rest of society. You look at the cost of the program, which is partly borne by taxpayers, some of it may also be borne by the participants, and you compare and see which one, you know, if the benefits exceed the costs. It's an indication that the program in some sense makes I call it a social profit. That is, you know, it's worth investing in from a social point of view, because on balance, the economy's better off, society's better off if with the programs that pass benefit cost tests. Now, in the social policy area, there have been hundreds, if not thousands, of benefit cost studies. And I must say, we're kind of living now, these days, the evidence base, including benefit cost analyses on social programs, effective social programs, is richer than ever. There's a whole slew of them out there that pass benefit cost tests. There is, I'm sure as many of you know, there are websites, clearinghouses that try to, in some sense, market or publicize the programs that seem to be the most promising in like juvenile justice or child welfare or education or work and training. So there's just lots of programs that if we could get consensus at the state or federal level would definitely be worth pursuing. That said, none of these programs will work miracles. They may pass benefit cost tests, but for most of them, the benefits, say per person, per participant, are on the modest side. So they all make things better, but there's no one program out there or two or three programs that we can count on. But that's the reality of making policy in such a complex area. Say it's a multi-pronged approach: prevention, mitigation, supplementing. And there's programs and policies in each of those areas that are worth expanding or they're worth implementing because they pass benefit cost tests. Let me mention a couple other suggestions I might have on anti-poverty policies, and then turn it over to you folks for questions and comments. A couple things that haven't been brought up at the moment. So on the prevention side, increasing earnings, you know, we live in a state with the highest minimum wage in the country. We're in Seattle, which is, you know, in the vanguard of raising the minimum wage. Tacoma, as you know, was voted in a higher minimum wage. And then SeaTac, which was the vanguard with its minimum wage. Those are all have the potential to increase in earnings and reduce poverty. At the same time, those are big increases, right, going to 15. So it's not... The jury's still out as to how effective those will really be. Will they raise earnings, or will they lead to job losses that actually hurt? Jennie and I are part of a team at the university that's working on an evaluation of the Seattle program. But certainly nationally speaking, where the minimum wage in many states is 7.25, raising it is kind of a no-brainer. Second earning strategy I think is really critical is helping former inmates get back into the labor market, get integrated into society. We could reduce the legal disqualifications for certain occupations, that if you have a criminal record. We can certainly just enact the reforms we need to reduce incarceration for so many offenses of basically non-dangerous folks. Aside from the earnings impact and the impact on the families that are left behind, this would do an enormous amount to redress racial inequities in the criminal justice system. Also on the prevention side, I think of we have a great earned income tax credit at the federal level. It'd be nice to increase its generosity to non-parents and to non-custodial parents because it induces them to work more. And you might say, well, non-parents, what's that do for kids? The point is most of those people will become parents in the nearer or not too distant future. We're talking typically folks in their early 20s. So if they get better integrated into the labor market when they have children, they're better positioned to support them. At the same time, the EITC makes an odd sense, of course, as a supplementing strategy. This state needs to fund, right, the Working Families Tax Credit. It was passed with Tony's work, what, 4, 5, 6 years ago? With the recession, with other priorities, we haven't funded it. But we would join roughly half the states in the country that have their own earned income tax credits, and that would be enormously beneficial. In general, the feds could raise the maximum benefit and otherwise make it more sufficient. A couple other things, because I do want to give you folks time. In terms of prevention, I talked about family structure issues, and the one, I think, policy that a lot of folks can get behind is reducing teenage pregnancies. And the vast majority of teen pregnancies are not wanted. And the key here seems to be, these days, would be to rely on long-acting reversible contraceptives. That's LARCs in the jargon. These, they work very effectively. The technology is much, much better than, say, 25 years ago with IUDs back then. It just could, it would help folks time their becoming parents when they want to be and not have it happen early. This is very good for the children because children born to teens are much likely to be raised in a poor situation, of poor families. It's got all sorts of benefits if we could only get a sensible policy to support aggressive subsidies of contraceptives. And I think the last thing I'll say, there's lots of things we could talk about, is about child support collections. On the one hand, child support's fundamental to a custodial parent and his or her children, and we need to do as good a job as we can with collecting it. But it's very hard, hard to collect folks who are low earners or out of work, very hard to get collections and to get them to comply. But there's some things steps we could take to improve that. There's a lot of talk and effort to do right-sized orders, so you give folks feasible orders that they can meet, which may encourage them to work rather than say, oh my God, I can never pay $400 a month and just disappear from the workforce or work off the books. Make it easier to modify orders when folks end up in jail or unemployed or have a severe illness so that during difficult times they're not building up debts. Debts can be very discouraging. If you have a child support debt of $15,000, $20,000, you may say, look, it's hopeless. Why even bother? So there's been proposals to try to write off some of those debts in return for example, keeping current with your obligations or being enrolled in some of the new emerging in Washington and other states efforts to enhance employment for non-custodial parents. So there's lots of strategies we could use for non-custodial parents that would benefit them in the longer run in terms of helping them do better in the labor market, and equally, if not more important, benefit the custodial parent and his or her children. And I think I'll stop there and take questions, comments from the audience. If anyone, or you want to
just want to make a quick comment following Professor Plotnick's comments. I have a simpler one than Professor Plotnick. Yes, three categories. I say, if you want to address poverty, you either raise income or you lower expenses, right? I mean, I think that's all I can keep in my mind, these two strategies. But, and so I totally agree with what Professor Plotnick said about the EITC, but I did want to say something about lowering expenses because, as Lori alluded to, the Western European democracies, they do a very good job. You know, France doesn't have a $20 minimum wage, but they have very, very generous, but they do have very, very generous programs. And I want to focus one or two comments on housing. You know, Reverend David Bloom, who many of you know, worked on housing issues here for many years. He reminded us, and I really hadn't thought about it until he said that, you know, we didn't have the kind of mass homelessness that we have today back in 1980, prior to 1981, okay? I remember, you know, we had, you know, the, what we call the hobos, you know, and the, you know, people living, you know, maybe in the parks and whatnot. But we didn't have the kind of mass homelessness that we have today, family homelessness, you know, single adults who are not disabled. And of course, what happened in 1981 is what? Ronald Reagan cut the HUD budget by, I think it was 90%, Nancy, is that correct? It was about 90%. Yeah. And so the federal government, which was really the main funder of low-income housing throughout the country, got out of the business of, you know, funding low-income housing, basically. And until we reverse that, no matter what we try to do in Seattle or at the state level, and by the way, we're doing a lot, by the way. We're one of the few states that has a housing trust fund. Seattle has a very generous housing levy, but that's not enough. And so I think there was a national campaign, as I understand it now, you know, let's say 5 million homes. I think people are talking about 5 million units. So I just wanted to remind people that, you know, this hasn't always been the way it is today, you know, and we really should not accept the kind of homelessness that we have today. And until we reverse that, I just really don't see us really turning, you know, making substantial dents in some of the problems that other people have alluded to.
Great, thank you all. I'd like to turn now to questions from you all. If I could, might I ask that you keep your questions and comments to about 30 seconds so that we can actually make a round here in the audience and give everybody an opportunity to ask questions. And please think about questions, ideas that you'd like for our panelists to respond to very specifically. So I'll take anybody who has. Do you want to start?
Yeah, so I guess I keep wondering that if income inequality continues to widen or deepen or whatever metaphor you want to use there, would any program or set of programs possibly work to reduce child poverty? So can a programmatic, whether it's two generation, three generation, whatever it is, if income inequality continues to be expanded, can any program or set of programs work?
I'll take the first try. Well, I guess one way I think of it is if we enacted some of these reforms we've talked about, especially on the labor market side, that would stop the inequality from widening for itself. So inequality hasn't been directly on the table, but it's very much a part in the background of this discussion for reasons that are sort of obvious. As you have more people at the bottom and at the top, poverty goes up. So I think of these as things that would both reduce poverty and inequality.
Yeah, and I mean, that's an excellent point. Yeah, I mean, like the minimum wage, for example, that deals with wage inequality, and that's certainly one part of reducing income inequality overall, but there's a lot of other things contributing to income inequality, and the other big piece of work at the Budget and Policy Center is our tax system. So for, you know, we have the most regressive tax system, you guys probably all heard this, most regressive tax system in the entire country. We tax the poor more than any other state in the entire United States. So people with the lowest incomes pay, as a share of their income, pay 17% toward taxes, whereas the richest people in our state pay just 2.5%. So not only does that undermine, is that part of this systemic problem that we have in creating poverty and making it really impossible for families, even those that are working, to meet basic needs and get ahead, it has the another impact that we're relying on people least able to pay into our revenue system to fund all the services that everybody needs in Washington State to really have the opportunity to thrive. So a huge part of the solution is tax policy.
You know, I started lobbying in Olympia in 1981. I was 5 years old. No, I... we had a huge recession in 1981. By 1983, 84, state revenues were growing at an incredible rate. We were able to restore programs like the adult dental program and Medicaid. We restored the cuts that we made to long-term care, home care. But since, I don't know, maybe the late 80s, we've had budget crisis after budget crisis. There hasn't been a year where we really had surpluses, you know? And now with the McCleary decision, you know, we are going to see red ink for the foreseeable future unless we do the reforms that Lori mentioned. So tax fairness, absolutely, and tax adequacy. We are not going to be able to fund the working families tax rebate. We're not going to be able to fund any of the things that Professor Plotney talked about or we talked about if we don't have revenues. And that's just a fact of life. The other comment I want to make, this is not meant to be a partisan dig, but, you know, people have to realize, but I was asked to say a few comments about the political context. People have to realize that, you know, the media tries to say, well, you know, Democrats and Republicans don't want to compromise. There's, you know, as Norm Ornstein, who's a conservative scholar, and Thomas Mann, who are the two most respected political scientists on congressional matters, they've written a book, I forgot what the name of the book was. Basically, their thesis, their argument is that in the last few years, the Republican Party has gone so far to the right, I mean so far to the right, they refuse to compromise, that to blame the Democrats and the Republicans alike is just simply ridiculous, this idea of fairness. And what I always say is, you know, if the Democrats had gone as far left as the Republicans have gone right, they'd be governed by the Trotskyites. I mean, really, I mean, you gotta think about it. And I want to remind people that Ronald Reagan, conservative icon, right? Big supporter of the EITC, okay, the Earned Income Tax Credit. And in 1983, he accepted the largest single tax increase in American history at that point because of the burgeoning deficit after the Kemp-Roth tax bill was passed in 1981. So Ronald Reagan accepted the largest single tax increase in American history to fund programs and to solve the deficit. And today, there isn't a single Republican, right? Are there any Republicans in the Congress who accept some sort of tax increase? Absolutely no. So the political context really has changed. And the same thing here in Olympia. You know, I've been here since 1981. And in 1981, 1982, there weren't the kinds of attacks on public education. I mean, there was consensus, bipartisan consensus on the need for K-12 funding. And today, you have the Republican Party basically saying, we're not going to fund McCleary, you know, we're not going to pay teachers adequately. So that bipartisan consensus really has just fallen apart.
Other questions from the audience?
Thank you all. And I mean, I'm assuming we're kind of opening this up to anybody, presenters, panelists, whomever. So not to just totally simplify things and to ignore the point about mental health, substance abuse, et cetera, all contributing factors. I guess I'm just curious, if we really were to embark on the kind of poverty reduction strategies, would we likely see a reduction in the number of families coming into the child welfare system?
Okay, yeah, can I just say that I wouldn't try to sell that idea that would automatically kind of happen. So one of the interesting things is, if you look carefully at both NCANS and APCARS, and so NCANS is the Federal Reporting System on Child Abuse and Neglect, APCARS is the Federal Reporting System on Foster Care. If you look at those kind of things,
And then you try to draw some kind of relationship between states that have high rates and their economic status, for example, their rank in kids count, something like that. It's all over the place. There are very seemingly wealthy states, as in New England, that have high rates of CPS response, and there are states that are very affluent that have low rates. Ditto for the states that are very poor. Some of the states that have the lowest foster care rates in the country are in the South, right, who have the poorest states. So it isn't just a function of economics solely, and so if advocates try to sell it like that, then it's likely that legislatures are going to see, well, that's just not true. I mean, a lot of other things go into it rather than poverty. There's also the issue of community standards. What kind of standards and laws are states actually applying here? And right, so it isn't just a function of the economics. It's not just a function of substance abuse, as important as that is. It's also a function of how communities think about things. And so you have in Scandinavian states, for example, you know, you have more of a social ethos, you know, the upper Midwest and so forth. Those have very high rates of CPS response, even though they are funding prevention programs much more than we're probably doing here in Washington. So you just got to be careful on what you promise.
Hands.
I just wanted to respond to Lori. I think what you might see is if there are interventions available pre-CPS, you might see the number of calls coming in to the department decrease. Because poverty is really what looks like, poverty can look like neglect depending on who you are. And so when you are looking at that, when you are looking at that child who looks like they're neglected because they've worn the same clothes every day or they're not, you know, they're sleeping in class or they're hungry, we do have a screening in child welfare that it does have to pass that meet that bar of sufficiency, but the numbers of calls might decrease into the system and the rates of disproportionality might decrease being called into child welfare. But I did want to just make one comment that I had the opportunity to work at ESA. I've been in child welfare for a long time, and I had the opportunity to work at ESA for a couple of years. And when I came back to child welfare, I was more keenly aware and had a greater understanding of how child safety is related to poverty, to housing, to transportation, to access to medical care, etc. So one of the things that we're doing at Children's is we are doing a workload reduction effort. And one of the things that will happen there is that the assessment is changing. And in the assessment, we will be assessing things like transportation, housing, basic needs, food. Is the family connected to Work First? Are they receiving TANF? We're also connecting the EJAS system or the ACEs system, which is the eligibility system at ESA, to our family system. So we'll be doing auto-population across systems so that we'll know that a family has a Work First worker, we'll know that they're receiving TANF. But we are going to embark on some poverty policy, if you will, and we are going to be asking our workers to do work. First, we're taking things away from them, Esther. And secondly, we are going to get real about true assessment and not just the assessment of abuse or neglect, but really the assessment of the context in which this is being reported or is happening. But I would join with Esther in saying that we will have better data on families that are connected to, are receiving TANF and are working with Work First. We will have better numbers on families that have no transportation and are relying on public transportation or on some kind of subsidy to help them. We will have better information about families that are homeless or unstably housed. But that's where we need the rest of the system to step up, because we can't provide all of those things. And that gets to Esther's point of our role is we have a clear role, but we need to work very closely with the other system partners because we cannot provide these families with their needs. So we have a lot of work to do in child welfare, I believe, and we have a great opportunity with our family assessment response pathway to do much more work around poverty and concrete needs. But we need the other parts of the system to help us. We need to leverage the access to transportation and housing and all of those needs that these families really struggle with every day. So, first of all, thanks for bringing to light all that is happening, and it's really encouraging to see how well this aligns with some of the stuff here. I know, as Maureen and I have gone out to talk to frontline CA and ESA workers, one thing that has come up at this point anecdotally is the family assessment response process can help bring more resources in. So that's encouraging. But I actually wanted to respond to Dee's point with a little bit more optimism. This was, he responded to the question kind of, if we address poverty, will we see fewer CPS referrals? And I absolutely agree this is a very tricky question to get good social science evidence on. And when you look across states, it's true that poor states don't necessarily look worse than wealthier states on some of these measures. And that's because they're very individualized systems within the states. That said, there's been some new research in the past few years that tries to use either a randomized experiment approach or a quasi-experimental approach where you kind of create a way to control for those differences in the states. One looked at the impact of the EITC, which has changed over time and which is different from state to state. A lot of states have EITCs, and increases in state EITCs or relatively more generous state EITCs were related to lower CPS involvement in those states. So that's actually some pretty good evidence there. We also have some colleagues nationally at the university, the other UW, University of Wisconsin-Madison, Christy Shook-Slack and Lonnie Berger, who have tested an intervention there with families at the first point of referral, most of whom are, I'm not a child welfare person, so let me know if I'm not getting the language right, most of whom are then not screened in, but are at great risk for future substantiation. And a fairly modest economic intervention with those folks seems to be reducing eventual substantiation. This is work that's still in the field. They're still analyzing it. The West Coast Poverty Center is actually bringing Lonnie to campus for a talk this coming spring. So I'll talk to David and Joe and see if that's something we can publicize to folks here too. But I don't think we should view the, I think there's some good new evidence that yes, these are very complicated systems, but reducing income inequality and increasing the income of the poor will help reduce CPS involvement.
And if I could just build on what Jennie's saying, I think, you know, we spend a lot of time thinking, well, should we do that? What's the evidence? And from a public policy perspective, to me, the theoretical evidence of the association of poverty and income inequality with every single outcome of child well-being at least gives the theoretical impetus to do it. That it's sure as hell worth a shot, given that, you know, given the outcomes that we see right now. So, you know, we make policy decisions all the time without evidence. Ronald Reagan cut 90% from a budget without any evidence of the impact. We cut $600 million from TANF without any evidence of the impact. I mean, given what we know, the volumes of the library, you know, in Suzalo and every single library on any campus in the United States on the impact of poverty and income inequality, the new ACEs data, I mean, to me, to answer Lori's question, the evidence to do it is there.
We have about 5 minutes left, and I'm actually going to suggest that we use those few minutes left to summarize what are the take-home messages for today, for from today's session. I wonder if any of you have, in 10 seconds or less, thoughts you would like to share with others about take-home messages. What did you learn today? How will you take this information forward?
I
this is just a small suggestion that I got from one of my former grad students. I now wear a self-printed badge when I go to Olympia that says, tax me, I'm no sissy. And if we're going to get any movement on tax reform, we have to be more visible about it, and I don't think we are.
Well, that was Nancy Amade who just said something. My name's Renee Murray, and I started out as a CPS worker in 1982 when Ronald Reagan was president, and now do legislative advocacy and chair of the Children's Campaign Fund. And my takeaway today is that we don't have, well, I'd love to hear more from Tony, but what else do we do to connect the dots between all of us in the room and our legislators, and not just in the Puget Sound, but we really have the other side of the state to convince. And I think that's my biggest, well, that's what I challenge us to do, and that's what I'll challenge myself to do.
More work to be done. Other take-home messages?
I'm Amelia Watson. I'm at the Washington State Office of Public Defense Parents Representation Program, and I just wanted to thank Maureen Marcenko for her suggestion of changing the TANF form to keep concurrent benefits and just making the assumption those benefits should continue. I think that's an easy fix. I don't have the capacity to do that, but I'm more than willing to advocate on behalf of someone at CA right now that does have that capacity. I'll come talk to you afterwards. See some people over there.
Couple more.
As a CASA volunteer for King County Superior Court for the past 13 years, one of the things that I've come to recognize is the importance of continuing to ask the questions and push in the systems that processes get in the way of making sure moms that are on a healthy track get the services that they need, asking the questions, why did the TANF, why is it not there? Understanding that a little better to ensure that the children have the best outcome with healthy families. So again, we get stuck in hearing a lot of, well, I have to make this referral, and then it takes 2 weeks. Why does it take 2 weeks? So to keep pushing that button and asking the questions why those benefits aren't there, that's very prevalent in this takeaway.
One last comment. Who's going to be our last ticker?
So I work with Children's Administration, and the biggest takeaway, I think, for me is the Children's Administration needs more resources. Right now, our caseload and our workload is too high. A program like Family Assessment Response, which we didn't really talk about at all today, isn't going to be adequate or sufficient if we don't have time to actually work with the parents to help them navigate the systems, to help work with them on how to keep their children safe if we've got so many cases that we're just running ourselves ragged. So I think that's the biggest takeaway, is we need to work with the state legislature to get more positions for Children Administration to get our caseload and our workload down.
Thank you. Thanks to every one of you for attending today. And let's give our panelists, our presenters, another round of applause. So in closing, I would just like to say on behalf of the planning group from the from Partners for Our Children, the School of Social Work, we really appreciate the turnout today, the effort that you all have put into being here with us. And it sounds like there's a lot more to discuss, a lot more to come. And I'm sure that our presenters will at some point have lots more to share. So thanks very much, and have a safe drive out of here. It's raining hard out there. Be safe on the roads.